Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Talking Consciousness podcast. My name is Unfortunate Chemistry, and today I have the Hikori Magician, and he's going to be sharing with us a lot of different experiences. He's had many experiences in very traditional settings, and I think we will be able to learn something from him and maybe gain some insights. But please bear with me if I cough or anything. I am like getting sicker and sicker as time goes on. And I don't know, maybe this is my last day. I don't know. I'm coughing like crazy. I'm going to try not to cough too much, but, yeah. So how's it going, man?
Hey, man. Well, happy new year to you and to everybody. And I wish everybody the best and just happiness in their own path to consciousness.
Okay.
And well, I can hear you sound like having trouble pronouncing how I want to be called is
yes.
Hikori. Hikori is peyote. And do you know what the peyote is?
Peyote?
Yep.
The cactus?
Yes, the cactus.
Okay. How do you spell this? The Hikori.
H-I-K-U-R-I.
Okay. So this is a type of peyote cactus?
No. In the ancient traditions of the Wirikutas, that's like an ancient tribe that still goes around.
Okay.
They call peyote hikuri. And after learning a thing or two, I'm starting a new career as a traveling magician. And I want to be known as the Hikori Magician.
Okay.
Because for me, it has a lot of meaning. And well, here in Mexico, we call also the peyote el abuelito. That means the grandfather.
Mm.
So, because he knows a lot. And well, I've gained some insight about me, my life, and my relationship with everything. And I think I can talk a thing or two about it. So I think I wear this name with pride, you know?
Yeah,
for
absolutely.
For me, it's super important. And it's something that I really want to share and everyone get to know.
All right. Well, why don't you take us back to the roots of how you got into this position?
Yeah. Well, I can tell you, man, the peyote, it's a calling. It's not for everyone. Almost with any psychedelic, it's not for everyone. But the peyote, for me, is something truly different. It's not like being in the Amazon with ayahuasca or the cambo. Have you ever heard about the cambo?
Yes, I have. The yeah, little frog.
Crazy, yeah, that green frog, it's crazy too.
It sounds really dangerous.
It sounds a bit extreme for my taste.
Yes.
But also here, like in Mexico, we have like the bufo, frog that gets like 5-MeO DMT. I haven't tried that one yet.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, it's medicine, man. It's medicine.
Yeah.
And you have to learn that to treat those things with absolute respect. I've seen many people get sick with plants of power, you know? It creates some gaps between this three-dimensional reality and the multidimensional universe.
Yes.
It's So it has to be taken with care and respect and actually just let go of everything. And the peyote, it's like I told you, man, it's a calling. You start to see the signs that is calling to you. For me, it was everywhere. I was having some issues in my personal life. Last year, I went to Canada around this time of the year, almost in December, because I was going to visit a girlfriend I had there. And like, I sold everything I had just to get with her and everything. But 10 days before I arrived, she was already with a guy from Chile. So I was like super sad and everything, but wow. It was a wonderful experience. And she is a beautiful person. I wish her the best. And everything happens for a reason. Right. And I truly understood that. And I was facing all that kind of feelings. And it was last year. And so many things started happening because after I came back from Canada, I started hosting via couch surfing. Have you heard about that one?
No, I have not.
No, it's like an Airbnb, but okay. It's for free. So, yeah, it's pretty cool.
So you meet a lot of people that way.
Yeah, a lot of people. Here, where I'm from, Mexico, I was born in San Luis Potosí. That is like in the way in the middle of Mexico.
Okay.
And this is just a desert. And where I stand right now is like a valley in the middle of the desert. So, yeah, and you start to realize some things. Why you came to exactly this place and how important it is to know that and to remember.
Yes.
So, like I told you, I started hosting a lot of people. And very far in between, I started to know some other kind of, really, really woke people.
Yeah.
I started talking in things at first I couldn't understand. I was like, oh, them hippie, he's way too stoned. But then I just started to connect certain things. One thing or another started to make sense. And once or twice I heard about the peyote from people that are a girl from Argentina. She was, shout outs to her, Ceci and Cami, las quiero mucho. And that means I love you a lot.
Okay.
She's a girl from Argentina. She's been traveling 5 years here in South and Central America with her child. And she's been traveling for 4 years and her daughter is five. So it's
her whole life.
It's amazing. Yeah, her whole life. And she makes like bracelets and all kinds of craftsmanship with rocks and everything.
Yeah.
So that's how she travels. Like it's like a true hippie. like a South American hippie that goes selling their crafts.
Yeah.
If you could see me like right now, my wrists are covered with all those wristbands I received as a gift, all with the stones, and I have a lot of colors that have a deep meaning for me.
Yeah.
And that's another topic I will bring, how the peyote has given me so much family around the world.
Wow.
And then I started looking into my own mental health. So I wasn't crazy or anything. Maybe I was a little bit depressed about all the things that started happening. I start to wonder, is it life just like you go out of college and you get a job and then you get married and that's it? You get a house and that's it.
Right.
And It for some reason I still couldn't believe that. Right now I'm 26 years old, and yeah, I couldn't believe that. I mean, I moved out from my mom's place around 5 years ago, and here in Mexico is not like common for the children to leave their parents' house until they get married. So yeah, it was like a complete separation of my family and everything, but it also had a meaning. And when you start connecting everything, I mean, you just, it's crazy. I don't know how to describe it. But it's a bliss, you know? When you start losing fear of leaving, truly magical things happen. Truly magical things. And well, back to the couch surf thing. So when I was in Canada, I didn't have any money, like just a couple $100 in Canadian dollars. So the way I could hold myself up was by doing magic in bars and everything. And it was super fun. I met a lot of people that way. And so many people helped me. And I learned that there are people around the world that they don't care where you're from or what you've done. They're here to help. And it's something, well, it's magical, you know, and I do believe in magic. And that's a message I want to bring with all of the illusions I do. I always tell all the people that I can show you even how to do this kind of magic, but what I'm giving to you is just, I'm just stimulating your sense of wonder. And that's something we need to remember because as adults, we lose it so easily.
Yeah, you're right.
And well, after returning and getting so much people here in my house, your mi casa tu casa, well, I started going to a psychologist and started talking me about everything, starting to realize a thing or two. But I've already had like the understanding of what the peyote is and what can do for you. And this time that my psychologist just told me, "Why don't you go eat peyote?" Now we're like, what? Yeah, we'll go for peyote. But then I started to look back and saw all the signs were there. And when in here in the city of San Luis Potosí, nobody, almost nobody, know what the peyote is. So they are scared of it. They think it's like a thing of the devil and things like that. But yeah, you can imagine. But it's something beautiful, man. It's pure bliss. I mean, it's.
Yeah, I haven't tried it, but I totally believe just based on my own experiences with other stuff. And yeah, I know how they get bad raps like that. I can tell you, my therapist would never tell me to go and use
Really?
peyote. No, here in America, they hate drugs. They hate anything that is considered a drug, and they don't think there's any like medical value to these plant teachers. Well, they wouldn't even call it that. They would just think it's just some way to get high, you know. They don't understand.
No, they don't. They absolutely don't because those are plants, man. I mean, those are being used since we started
Thinking,
walking on
walking,
this earth.
yeah.
So yeah, I mean, then I started to see everything as a sign for the peyote. Here we have a lot of cactus and many ways of cactus that you probably haven't seen if you haven't come to Mexico. Have you ever been here in Mexico, man?
I have not.
No, if you ever come, just let me know. I'm super happy to host you, man.
Awesome.
Yeah, my house is your house, mi casa tu casa. So I'm just happy to receive many people that it's interesting and have the same affinities.
Okay.
You start, when you're on the same frequency, people just comes, you know?
Yeah.
It's like an upward spiral.
Yeah. And, you know, the opposite's also true. Once you start getting out of frequency with people, they go away, man.
Yeah.
I'm kind of learning that in my own life right now.
Yeah, exactly, man. But it's a bad of knowledge and everything. And it all happens for a reason.
Yeah.
And even though we are tempted to ask why, along the way, we all see it all happens for a reason. I learned in my meditation that the past doesn't exist and the future is just an illusion.
Yes.
So what we have right now is the present.
Yes.
And that is a gift. That is why it's called a present.
Right. Yes. That's exactly right.
So, yeah, when you start living and enjoying what you have right now, not worrying about what you don't,
yeah,
it completely changes your life and your output. It do it for me. I'm just a simple guy, a simple magician that's trying to learn a bit more. So what I can tell to you or everyone here, it's just my own experience. I don't have like all the truths and all the knowledge.
Yes.
But, and I respect what everyone says and everyone's point of view, because this is tricky. Spirituality, consciousness, and psychedelics are tricky. I met so many people that have a different knowledge. So they always start talk that they are living, and we are right now living in an illusion. And when they die, they will return to their own planet. And that's why they live there just day by day. They don't save a penny. What they do to get a coin for the day, they use it on the same day. So, and just walk the earth like all way.
Yeah.
And it's super interesting when you have those kind of people. I've learned not to judge.
Yes.
To embrace everything. And just sometimes you cannot hold on to people or things or everything. We all are in our own path.
Yeah.
And
no path's that's powerful, better than anyone else's. Everybody's got their own path.
Yeah. Everyone. And maybe at some point all of our frequency will be so elevated and we were all in. It takes us to a leap in our evolution and to take care of this beautiful planet we have.
I hope so, man.
But yeah, man. Yeah, it's our only hope.
Yeah.
So, when I started looking a bit more about the peyote, then a friend of mine just sent me a message out of nowhere. By the way, if you want to eat peyote, go to this place, El Tecolote. And El Tecolote, that means like the owl.
Ooh.
And the thing is, when you go for peyote, it's not easy. You go to a really harsh desert. It's in the middle of nowhere. People get lost, you can get killed, you can die. There are a lot of wild animals and insects and everything. Getting to there is not an easy task. Even if you go by car and everything, you still have to walk several hours under the blazing sun. And you will get hurt by one or two cactuses and everything. So it's an intense experience. It's an intense adventure just to go there.
Yeah, that's That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, man, because, you know, the desert can show you a thing or two.
Yeah, I've never had to have a struggle to get a psychedelic, you know. It's been really easy for me. I've never had to journey. It's
really?
It's like you're taking a trip to get a trip.
exactly, that's what it is. What things have you tried already? I mean, what's your favorite, man?
Honestly, my favorite is edible cannabis.
Oh, really?
And really high doses, yes. But, you know, I've dabbled in a few different things. I got started all natural with the Morning Glory seeds, which I don't know if you have in Mexico if they have the kind that I had, but I know in Mexico they have a sister plant called Aliloque, which is chemically the same. It's the same psychedelic. And then, I've done some other stuff. And up next, my next trip is going to be ayahuasca. Which I'm going to be brewing myself.
Really?
Yes.
How did you learn to do that?
Just research. Not in any formal way. Just did a lot of research. Unfortunately, at this time, it's not even possible for me to get to Peru for a ceremony. So I kind of had to take things into my own hands.
Oh, that sounds super interesting, man. Super, super interesting. And I wish you the very best for that. Ayahuasca is super strong medicine. I've seen a lot of people just change after that. After ayahuasca, they're not the same anymore.
Yeah, I'm looking for it for some insights, and I think it'll have a lot to teach me. But I'm going to go in gentle. I'm not going to just, you know, go in like head first. I'm going to taste it, see if she has any message for me and whether or not I should go ahead and take the rest.
Oh, that's probably a smart thing to do. I think last month I had a girl that she was from Chile. And she started traveling since she was like 18 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And she's been trying ayahuasca for several years now. She's not connected anymore. And that's the thing with medicine. When you have like a certain enjoyment of it, out of it, it can also punish you.
Right.
And
that's the thing with ayahuasca that I'm going to be careful. It's just, I don't want to disrespect it. And if I think she'll tell me if I'm disrespecting her, and I'll back off if that's the case. I don't want to displease the plant mother.
Yeah. Yeah, you're doing the right thing. And I super wish you the very best out of their experience. And I'll be hearing the later podcast.
Yes.
How was your experience? It's super interesting when you have someone that has like the visions of ayahuasca.
So pretty soon too, I was looking into doing a San Pedro cactus experience.
Oh, San Pedro, yeah.
But I just don't know when I'm going to do that yet.
Will you be traveling to the south, or how do you plan to get it?
I'll be ordering the cactus and preparing it myself.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. The San Pedro, it has to be brewed, doesn't it?
Yes. Yeah, it would be like a tea or something of that nature.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that sounds great. And, the peyote, you only eat it. There's a certain way to cut the peyote.
Mm-hmm.
Because the peyote is such a tiny little cactus that it's if you touch your index and thumb together, like making an okay,
Yeah.
a peyote is like the size of that.
Right.
And what you can see that it's coming from the earth is like your thumb only. That from your nail to the other part, it's like that how tall it is.
So
But
it's they're hard to find then, aren't they?
it's super hard to find, man. It's super hard because that's the thing. Peyote finds you. You don't find the peyote.
Right.
Because if you go there expecting a trip or something, most probably you won't even see one.
Right, because it's
It's,
just disrespectful, basically.
yeah, I think that is. And it gets lost so easily. It's so funny, man. It's so funny because even though you leave signs that one is there, you probably never see it again. It's magical. Peyote is magical. The thing with peyote is that in the ancient tradition of our culture, the wirikutas, I mean the huicholes, was a tribe that was about to die because they ran out of food and they ran out of water and everything. So they started walking. And this place is a sacred place because it resembles an eagle. And at the top and the head is like a mountain. But that mountain looks like the head of an eagle. And man, when you camp in the desert, that mountain, it glows, man. It really glows. It has a glow. Because during the desert, there are no cities, there are no, it's
Yeah.
just sand and rocks and plants. But that thing, it glows, it has a light. And for the Huicholes, that place is called El Cerro del Quemado, that roughly translates to the Burned Man Hill, because for them, that's the center of the universe. And that's where the sun was born.
Wow.
Because when you see the sunrise from there, it just comes from that place. You see it? Oh, it's beautiful, man. I don't even know how to describe it. But at night, something happens because down there, there are a lot of minerals and lots of gold and crystals and everything. And there's a phenomenon that all of the gas that are below the earth, they emanate to the top, and that creates like a window that clears the sky. And when you're there, man, you see the stars, you see the shooting stars, you see Mars and everything like
Wow.
you've never seen before. You see the Milky Way, like the foam, and oh, it's something beautiful, man. It's out of the ordinary. You sense an immense amount of power there, an immense amount of power.
Right.
The people there used to do, well, they still do their rituals, and they practice like hardcore rituals with blood and everything. So it's pretty intense. I wouldn't recommend camping there if you don't have like a lot of experience in the desert. It's a bit scary when you're alone, especially.
Right.
But that's the experience with the peyote. So those huicholes, when they were about to die in the desert, they saw a blue deer. A deer, can you believe that? A blue deer.
yeah.
And for them, the deer are sacred animals, but it also represented food and supplies.
and they follow with him, and with every step of the blue deer, a peyote was born.
Wow.
So they ate the peyote and gave them enough strength to keep walking and to get to that, to El Cerro del Quemado. And that region, it's called Wirikuta. And when you're there, man, it's, yeah, man, you don't see that every day.
Yeah, that sounds amazing.
Yeah, it's amazing. This New Year's Eve, I went there. It was my third time going there. And I stumbled with, I met El Jefe. El Jefe del Desierto. The boss of the desert. He's like a living legend there. When you start asking for El Tecolote, that place, and they ask to you, are you looking for El Jefe? And El Jefe is a guy that he's not a shaman. Him and his family are guardians of those places. And it's super funny. When you meet that guy, he dresses like an army man.
Okay.
All in camo suit and everything. So it's super bizarre to see someone in the desert always looking like that. And he carries his machete and everything. So if you're not from around here, it will probably shock you. It's a living legend. One day, there will be a lot of music and things dedicated to him and his family. And have you ever heard about Maria Sabina?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, he is like the Maria Sabina. Him and Panchito, his relative, I don't remember what he is, are Maria Sabina of the Peyote.
Okay.
So many people from all around the world, if you search for El Jefe del Desierto in Google, you'll get a lot of results and you'll see videos and music and everything. That guy started writing poetry also and carves stones that I just happen to have here in my hand, one that he gave me. It has a meteorite and carved on a rock. It's like a peyote.
Wow.
So, yeah, those things are beautiful, man. And meeting El Jefe is super, it's an experience, man. It's crazy. So, well, going to the desert is funny because you can sense and feel and see the balance between life and death.
Right.
Because cactus have been there for so long, man. And they will outlive us all if the earth conditions are good and we don't fuck up the entire planet or everything.
Yeah.
Don't you worry about that, man? But
yeah, a lot. It's something that it seems like no one cares.
I think we're only people that are in this frequency knows.
Yeah.
How important it is to take care of this place. We were put here for a reason.
We're not going to Mars. Some people think that we're going to Mars and it's okay to destroy the Earth, but we're not going to Mars. You got to make the Earth last, and there's a lot of life on this planet that doesn't have a say in what we do to it.
Man.
Yeah.
It's horrible.
Yeah.
Have you heard the news about that the president of Brazil, that he was going to take the Guaranis out of their lands?
No, I didn't hear about that.
Yeah, that guy is crazy, man. That guy is fucking crazy. And he's, well, we'll see. Hopefully, something. I don't know. It all happens for a reason, even that. At some point, we will have to learn.
Yeah, maybe it's all just building to one major,
Yeah.
one moment that everything changes altogether.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that too. And I don't know if I'm going to be there or we're going to be there to see that.
Right.
I really hope it. I mean, for this is our home, man.
Yeah.
This is our casa. So, okay, back to the desert. It's super
Yes.
interesting. When I first go there, went there, I met Panchito, and if you ever seen like an old Western Mexican film, it was like that. The guy, he was like
Yeah.
a farmer that works the field with her goats, and that's the only source of income and food. They only eat tortillas and cheese.
Right.
They have the goats for the cheese and the corn for make tortillas, and that's it. So, and just talking to them, and those are like the happiest, most sharing, most welcoming, and most heart, biggest hearts on earth.
It's
And
amazing,
they're
isn't
just,
it?
it's amazing. They have so little and they are so happy.
Right.
And you start to realize that kind of things. Most of the things, the actual things we have are things that we don't need.
Absolutely.
And I mean, with all of the industry, we just create waste, and it's scary sometimes.
Yeah.
Because the nature provide us all, and we just manufacture it and sell it, and yeah, yeah, it's crazy, a bit sad, but it's our reality.
Yeah.
And well, when I met him, I was like in awe, you know, because I'm like, wow, with this person, you feel this energy. And you know that this guy knows a thing or two better than everybody else. So it was a super long trip just to go there. And I only ask him for the peyote. Why does it have so many nicknames? In Mexico, we have different nicknames for peyote. It's like mezcalito, abuelito, venado, abuelo, maestro, genio, jicuri, and all those kinds of things.
Yeah.
So I asked him, why does he have so many names? And he told me, well, what's your name? And that. Okay, what if I call you like Big One? I'm just calling you like that because I just know you. It's just a nickname. But there's a thing you need to know. Every peyote is different. Every peyote has like, I don't know how to say it. When you peel like an orange or a tangerine, what are the name of the pieces of like each section? Does it have a name in English?
I'm not sure what it is actually, but I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Okay. Well, the peyote has also like those divisions. Those
Yes.
how did I say to you? Those
Like sections.
sections. And when it has five, it has name, because the peyote has you can see it in 5, 7, 11, 13, and up to I'm 13, it takes like, I don't know, maybe 100 of sections. And each one has their own purpose. One, you can use it for healing, use for like medicine. If something hurts, there's like several ways to consume and to use the peyote. Panchito told me about a guy that he was using like, how do you say it? The things you use to walk, the pieces of, I mean, the like crutches.
Crutches.
And that guy is a rich doctor from Guatemala. And that guy was using the crutches because he had an accident and went looking for Panchito, hoping that he could help. So they went to a place and they cut many peyotes. They put it in a bottle of with alcohol, just, I don't know how to say, like raw alcohol, not drinkable alcohol. And they buried it for a year. And the next year, that young guy came, and until the bottle emptied, he rubbed all the alcohol with the peyotes on his body. And when the bottle was empty, the guy could walk again without the help of the crutches. Wow. So it's medicine, man. It's...
Yeah.
I also met a guy that he's like a cyclist. We met there with his girlfriend in September. And that guy did the same, just got some peyotes, took a bottle of alcohol, and he took it because he told me it can help to relieve the pain of cycling and all the legs and everything. So it's medicine, man. It's pure medicine.
Right.
And when it has seven sections, that one is used to see things.
Right.
The first one I consumed, I don't know why. I was in the desert and I could see so many like coyotes, but it's funny because I could only see like if they were picking from a cactus, like, and they looked at me and I looked at them and they just came back. They returned. I mean, they like hit again in the cactus.
Yeah.
And they were gone. And I was, and for me, it wasn't like, it's not like a tall desert or anything. They couldn't have gone anywhere. I don't know if those were real or not.
Yeah.
But I think coyotes are something to me. And when you see a peyote with 11 or 13 sections, you get into deeper meanings. The teacher and the granddaddy. I asked him, why is it called the granddaddy and the teacher? He says, the teacher, it will show you things. It will make you learn a thing or two. Okay, I get it. And the granddaddy, and Panchito just laughed. Ha ha ha. No, the granddaddy is the one that is tough with you, that punishes you, that puts you on your knees until you learn. And yeah, man, when you see a granddaddy, you treat it with respect.
Right.
And the thing is, if you ever consider anyone that is considering doing peyote, the best way to do it is you're first you set up your camp, and then you start looking for a way to start the fire, to gather, how is it called, wood to use for the fire.
Yeah.
What's the name of that?
Kindling or tinder?
Yeah, tinder. So, and if you see one, when you're collecting, that one is yours. You, and how you cut it is when you see it, you, with your finger, you start like drawing an outline. So it reveals a little bit more, and with a string, and you cut, like you put it around, how can I say it? It's like you're trying to strangle it, and then you start to cut little by little. Then you get it, you tank to the desert, you cover the piece that it's exposed with dirt, and maybe make an offering if you want. And the peyote has like a hair, like has seeds, yeah, but looks like hair. So you have to take them off and eat each section one piece by piece. That's how you will get his power, eating it section or section. So if it's 5, it's easy. 7, it's easy. 11, 13, gets a little bit trickier. Because the thing with peyote, it has such funny taste. The first one goes like nothing. Oh, okay, it doesn't taste bad. It's like broccoli. But by the second one, you start sensing and feeling the mescaline.
Mm-hmm.
Your mouth starts to make foam, it makes you gag, and well, you don't wash the peyotes, you eat it with the dirt and everything. That is how it's supposed to be done.
Right.
So, it's difficult, man. So, going there, seeing it, discovering it, and eating it are just tests.
They're all so very difficult.
Yeah, everything it's extreme, you know.
And then if you actually eat one of the 13 section ones, that part's going to be very difficult as well.
Yeah, it's going to be very difficult, but it's worth it because that you're going there exactly for that.
Yeah,
you're going to meet el abuelito. So you're not going to say, oh, okay, yeah, that's it, I'm done, I'm back to my home and to watch some Netflix.
Right.
And if something happens to you, there are lots of snakes there, so you have to be careful or go with someone that knows or have the belief, the blessing to know someone like Panchito that shows you where the peyote is. And so the thing is that you can only eat the peyote that your soul that you need, no more, no less. Because the peyote, you don't eat it with your mouth, you eat it with your heart. So it's, for me, it has a bigger meaning. If you ask me, what is the peyote? I am peyote. And peyote is me.
Wow.
And yes, I've learned so much about that experience because the thing is that it's a bit difficult to realize what's happening with you when the peyote is inside of you. It's super hard to hold it in your stomach.
Mm-hmm.
And by the second one I ate, I was puking my brains out. and you can feel like you're puking everything, like, but in reality, you're not puking anything.
Wow.
It, for me, it was cleaning. It was a cleansing.
Right.
I was getting rid of all of my fears. Because in the desert and with the peyote, what you're doing is looking at the dead to his eyes and say, I'm not scared. And when you face that death, and also comes with the ego, the death of your ego, with the mescaline.
Yes.
You have already experienced death. So you are not afraid to live anymore.
Right.
All the colors, you see differently. You remember the joy of being a kid, to see the beauty of the sky, to find joy even in the smallest rocks on the dirt, to see how different every cactus is. And then you think, I'm cutting a peyote that took maybe 50 years to grow, and I just took his life.
Right.
And, well, it's just a sensibilizer, you know? It just makes you more sensible.
Yes.
To see your relationship with Mother Nature. Because that's only what I think. I mean, you can think, and everyone can think the same, and we all respect that. And for me, that's what God is. It's everything.
Yeah, same.
And we are all. And just start to realize your relationship with everything. And it's beautiful.
Yes.
Because you have accomplished something that most people don't. You don't got it from your nearest dealer. You didn't got it, like, you didn't pay for a ceremony to a so-called shaman.
Yeah.
Once I heard Terence McKenna conference, and he said something that I really liked, that the shaman is not your teacher. The plant is your teacher. A shaman is going to be there to take care of your three-dimensional body while your consciousness is being taken to a different level.
Yes. Yeah, I love that too, man. Yeah, I've heard that.
Yeah. It's amazing. And it just makes sense.
Right.
And when you're there alone, well, man, because you're there alone. Most people go there in groups. I met different people that I'm the only guy that has been like there alone. But that's the thing I too understood with the peyote. It's okay to be alone.
Yeah.
It will probably be difficult or something, or have a little fear, but it's okay. It will pass. It's just a moment, and every moment will too shall pass. And if then you start doing more things by myself, you know?
Yeah.
I start discovering more things about what I like and what I don't, and where I want to go and what I don't want to do. Because right now I'm working a 9-to-5 work, that 8-to-5 work. And that right now for me is not life anymore. It's not, it simply is not.
Yeah.
I cannot comprehend when you're in a job that you don't like, with people that you don't care, doing things that have no interest to you.
Yeah.
Just to get money and save. And for me, that just doesn't make sense anymore.
Yeah, I feel
so
you, man.
That's what I'm
And that's the thing, the one of the realizations I got with the peyote. The first thing it said to me, the lesson I got, patience. Patience. It all has a reason.
Yeah.
And the universe is, will put people on your path, will be the people that you must know, and you will learn what you must learn. And you just have to be open to that, you know, and receive all of the energy of the universe.
Yeah.
And when you start, when you don't have any fears anymore, you get so amazed of everything that it just starts happening. And how that a girl that left me in Canada took me to a place of higher consciousness, medicine, so many, many friends, man.
Yeah.
Because with the peyote, the thing is, when you're in the desert, probably you're not alone. The maybe like 2 kilometers from where you are, there are probably other guys having their own experience.
Right.
And at some point you will cross and you feel the compassion of everyone that's going there. Hey man, do you need some water? Are you okay with food? How was your trip?
Right.
And what did you learn? And how was it, man? How many did you took? Did you take?
Yeah.
And you start making so many friends.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's awesome, man. Because the peyote has given me that also. Friends that I can trust that are all around the world. All around the world, man. I feel so lucky to have them. I couldn't be anything if it wasn't for my friends. So shout out to all of my friends.
For sure.
To everyone, I'm just so happy to get to know you and all the special people. Everyone. It's a super long list. I don't know if I can name it all. Ceci Cami, Paula, and especially Daniela. With the peyote, I also understood love, you know?
Yeah.
Unconditional love.
Yeah.
Because love, I even wrote that thought. Because when on my second trip to the desert, I met two girls, one from Argentina, Carolina, and the other one from Brazil, Dani. And it was crazy because I was taking my things. I just had my second trip. I will tell you more about it in just a second. And then I saw like a small girl that he was like in fetal position on the ground. And the first thing I thought it was, is she real or am I?
Right.
But then I came closer and oh no, she's real. But she was like shaking. I was like, oh, I guess she's having a bad trip. So are you okay? I just touched her a little. And when I came close, she was feeding a baby goat. And that's why she was like on the ground.
Wow.
I don't know. And she told me that in her peyote ceremony, she connected so much with that baby goat that it was now her own son.
Wow.
And she was having like also her own difficulties in life. And well, I told her, it was my last day there in the desert. And I told her, if you ever come to San Luis, here's my number. Go to my home, it's your home too. And we talk for a moment, and
Well, she came here and she lived here like 2 weeks, and I loved every second of it, every second. Because love is not being selfish, it's not expectation,
Yeah.
it's not fear or doubt, and you don't plan it. It's not suffering, it's not lies, it's not resignation, it's not sadness, it's not deception. It's not envy or loneliness. You can't compare it, or you can't buy it or sell it. It's not desire, a cling. I don't know how to say it in English, to cling
Yeah.
or ego in any of its disguises. And it's completely the opposite. And you don't have to, and for me, it was like there's no need to having a person there to feel love. And that's what unconditional is.
Yeah.
Unconditional. And Danny, she's like one of the people I've loved the most, is very at the top. Such a beautiful soul, man, such a beautiful soul.
That's great.
But it wasn't sexual or anything, you know?
Yeah.
It was like it's just what it is. And she's not into men, and so it wasn't available or anything. And it was funny at the end too. But it's like loving your sister, or, and not having only a desire or the possession, you know,
Yeah.
because you know people have their own path. And it's for their own happiness and for our own happiness too. So we have to be grateful for all the lessons that we've learned. And that's what Danny is for me. So Danny, if you're hearing this, I love you very much. You know that there isn't a single day that I wouldn't say that. Right now she's in Hawaii. And remember that goat I told you about? Well, he was eaten by a coyote, and she was
Oh no.
completely, yeah, she was destroyed, and I'm super sorry for that. But hopefully, when the time is right, she will feel better, and we all learn. We will have learned a lesson there about many other things. So, okay, back to the peyote.
Okay.
So, by the third one I ate, my body was in shock. I was shaking. I was bah, 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 bah. I saw my hands, and they were like, I don't know what's happening to me. And then I closed my eyes for a second, and everything, they were all like snakes. There were snakes all around. And I could see them. But then I opened my eyes and I was like, oh, I'm in the desert. This is scary. Okay. But I'm here. And then I saw the stars. Man, where you. Most of the observatories are in the deserts because I don't know exactly why. I'm not an expert, but. How you see the sky in any desert, it's different.
Yeah.
No lights, no anything. And in the sky, it looks only like a black cloth with diamonds, and they are all shining, and oh, it's crazy. And I could feel like every star was connected. And they were all doing like this geometry and sacred geometry.
They are.
And I start, yeah, it's crazy.
They are, man. That's real.
Oh, now we understand that.
Yeah. Oh. It's all connected, man. This is all connected.
It's all connected. It's all connected, man. It is. It is. And I was amazed. I mean, I've never seen that kind of beauty there. And then I looked at the Cerro del Quemado, remember the hill of the burned man?
Yeah.
And I was like, how is this glowing like that? It has no sense, but it does. Glows. When you're there, you can put a coin like vertical and it will stay like that. If you can put an egg on top of another egg, I don't know why it has so much energy.
Really? Wow.
It's true, man. It's true. It's crazy. Mexico, it's beautiful, man. I'm so proud to be Mexican because we have so much beauty here. We have beaches and deserts and mountains and forests and food and good people and very attractive woman and very good friends and tequila and mezcal and Corona. Yeah, I'm just so happy to be here, you know?
Yeah.
I love my country. I love my heritage.
That's awesome.
And I love the traditions, the medicine we have here. We have mushrooms. We have peyote. We have the bufo. And we have so many, many different things in this country. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. And
yeah, unfortunately, I don't really have much heritage. Since my country's very young and we stole it from the natives.
It's crazy, isn't it?
Yeah, so I'm like totally derived of any heritage in that way. It's really sad.
Yeah, but have you considered traveling, man? Just going other place, like
I've considered it. Finances is a problem, though.
Yeah, I know that. I know that. Well, hopefully you can make it sometime to Mexico and
yeah.
And just let me know, man. It's a place of wonders.
Yeah, sounds amazing.
Yeah, it is amazing, and lots of things will happen. And well, Mexico, it's so beautiful, you know.
Yeah.
And well. After looking at El Cerro del Quemado, I looked at other cactus and all of them started looking like people. So, but only like shadows of them.
Yeah.
And the top of one hill, there was like a big one, like I could feel like that shadow. And it was like a fat one. And somehow I could feel that that was a woman. And I could feel that that was my mother. And there are many things I have learned to know your roots, and family is always there. No, it's difficult. I have three brothers.
Yeah.
We don't talk to each other. Well, I don't. I'm like the black sheep. And my mother, she doesn't talk to me a lot. But, I mean, she brought me to life, you know?
Yeah.
I didn't know my father until I was like 20, 23 or 21. I don't remember, but those two guys are the reason I'm here.
Yeah.
And just happy to be here, you know?
Yeah.
Because that's what you learn, that, and that's
also what when you see in the Xinjiang and everything, that there's good in the bad and the bad in the good.
Yes.
There's, have you ever heard about, just let me remember the name of this guy that has a teaching that's super interesting. Okay, a teacher of Zen, and
oh, of Zen, okay.
just yes. Just looking at it, because that guy is important. It's the founder of this, it's called, I have it right here, Dasira Narada. Have you ever heard that one?
No, I have not.
Dasira Narada means what it is in the sky and what is on the earth, they convert to one, and when they spin, they turn into nothing. So that's the sign of the Jin Yang. When you spin that wheel, it turns into nothing.
Yeah.
And what is in the sky is cosmic energy. And what is in the earth is us. And what is spinning? And those are our chakras. And it's funny because chakra means wheel in,
yes,
I don't know, it's something from India.
Yeah.
But in Mexico, we too had the, or Toltecas also knew about chakras, but they called them black holes.
Oh.
And so you start to realize that everything is connected.
Yeah.
And ancient people knew a thing or two about this place, this universe, and there's a reason what they were taken down.
And yeah.
Super interesting, man. And
Yeah,
so
that is really
you start to see
fascinating.
that there's good in bad and bad in good. And I wanted to take a closer look, and I wanted to speak to my mom in the form of that cactus and ask for her forgiveness for being not the best son, because I've always been a part of my family, completely apart. And when I return to the peyote right now, my relationship with my mother has never been better. That doesn't mean that we talk, laugh and everything, but in 5 years, I've never given a hug to my mom. And after that, well, my mom doesn't like hugs, but I do. But it's funny that how a simple plant can show you so many things.
Yeah.
And well, here's a funny thing that before I realized, it became super late and the sun was down. I was so into looking at the stars and everything that I didn't have the chance to set up my camp. So I had to stay on the ground with nothing on top. It was super intense, man, because I made some beans. It might be a stereotype, but I love me some beans. So I took some beans. And so I cooked them, and at night there are so many animals in the desert, and they were all like next to me looking at the food, and it was super scary because there are like rats that get on 2 feet and have like this super long tail, and when they see you, they jump. They are like the Speedy Gonzales. So they run and they jump, and it's
if you're not used to see that those kinds of animals, it's a bit scary. And it got even darker, and I could hear the coyotes, and I had so much cold, and it was super intense. But it was beautiful, man. It was beautiful. Every time I return from the desert, I feel like braver, you know?
Right.
Because something happens, and I feel like a Mexican warrior that is there, because that's what it is. We're all warriors.
Yeah.
And our traditions, my traditions show that we had to be warriors. And it's beautiful. It just is.
Yeah.
And I started getting those realizations, and because the trip itself, the thing with, with the trip, is not like super visual or anything. You will need a super higher dose of mescaline, and that takes a lot of peyotes. And there are lots of ways to that people do that. They cut a lot of peyote, and they let them all to dry, and they take everyone, they all of them, and they pulverize, so they make like pellets, and that's what they eat. Or if not, they just take all of the peyote, a lot of peyote, they squeeze them and make a juice, so they don't have to eat them, and it just shoots you to a different place, you know.
Yeah, and I've actually read about that becoming a problem, where people are over consuming them, and because they take so long to grow, that it's like endangering the population of peyote.
Yeah, it is. It's a problem, man, because, I'm going to be honest, and this is very important to me. It's super personal, and I want to say it out loud so everyone can hear it, because this New Year's Eve, have you ever read the Aldous Huxley, the Doors of Perception?
Yes.
So it's a great book. So anyone that hasn't read it, it's super nice. And
yeah, it's great.
You should try reading The Teachings of Don Juan from Carlos Castaneda.
I haven't read that. I've been wanting to read that for a long time.
Oh, man, those are... You can get those. There are lots of teachings there. I've learned how to control my dreams. And that's another level, man, because it's scary. When you communicate with people in your dreams, it's crazy. And it is becoming a problem, so that we are cutting so much peyote. And this New Year's Eve, after finishing that book, I was thinking, no, I think I need a higher dose. The first time I ate 4, the second time I ate 6, and this time I wanted to double that. But when I went there, I met a girl that told me about these many recipes and how to have like a ego, like a instant ego death trip. And we went there and we got a lot of peyote. I've never regretted anything in my entire life than cutting all of those peyote. I regret it so much, and I feel so ashamed, man.
Yeah.
I don't know what I was thinking, you know?
and getting caught with one head of one peyote, if you get caught by the police that can dwell there, it can happen. If they find you one, it's 10 years of jail. And have you ever heard about Mexican prisons?
In like movies.
Oh, it's worse than movies, man. Because when you go to the Mexican jail, you have to get money. You get charged for everything. You want to take a bath, you need to pay. You want to sleep in a bed, you have to pay. You want to eat, you have to pay. Everything has a cost there. If not, you will sleep on the ground, probably next to someone that is very touchy. So it's not something that it's good, you know?
Yeah.
So the police there, it's they're just assholes, man. They are looking for to people that are there for the same thing. And if they find you, they will try to get to you, and they will make you fear, and they will take all of your things, all of them.
Yeah.
So you have to be careful with that. And well, we returned to the camp, and there were many other people there, because in New Year's Eve, that place is filled with so many different people. And this New Year's Eve, there was like, I met this girl, shout outs to her, the Greece, I know you understand English, so I'm sorry if I didn't say anything. I didn't know. I also was super high. It's not an excuse, but I'm sorry. Probably you won't forgive me, but I truly regret what I did. So this girl I went with, she showed all of the peyotes she had. And then everyone was like, whoa, no, that's not good. No, everyone just started like, just getting into her. They're like, what you did was wrong. The desert has no guilt of your problems. And that was the most stupid thing you could do. You're killing, that's being a predator, and
right.
You're nothing. And I don't know, to be honest, man, we were smoking, and I don't really have like a big tolerance. And I wanted to say something, but in my head, it was like, did I say that or did I think that?
Right.
So I couldn't say anything. I could have defended her and do something or said something, or at least said, I too cut a lot of, too cut a lot of peyote. And well, this third time, the peyote gave me even more insight. There are lots of things happened in New Year's Eve, but after that I went to sleep, and I've eaten only like a section. We did a ritual with many dancers. We were in a temazcal. A temazcal is like a temazcal. It's like, imagine like a hot sauna that you make in the desert.
Yeah.
With all kinds of like clothes. I don't know, the bed sheets, but the thick ones. I don't know.
Yeah, with all around a fire. And you,
yeah,
it's
yeah,
like
yeah,
a
yeah.
Sweat lodge. I've heard of those.
That one, exactly that one. And in that ceremony, we shared some pieces of peyote. And it was at night, I could feel that piece of peyote. And it was so hard, man. It was so hard. When I closed my eyes, where I was trying to sleep, my eyes, everything was covered with peyote. everything. But remember the seats I told you? They have like all around.
Yeah.
They were eyes, like yellow eyes, like devil eyes, and they were all looking at me, angry. And I wasn't scared. I knew what I did was super wrong, and I regret it completely. And then just everything went black, and one peyote popped out of nowhere in my closed eyes, and it moved like a snake, like it moved, and the trail just were a lot of peyotes. And instead of now eyes, they were claws, like trying to hold me. And I could hear the peyotes that I had hidden. They were screaming at me. And I've never felt so bad, man.
Wow.
Nature demands respect too.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. When you're dealing with these kinds of things, it's also medicine, but it can also make you sick.
Right.
You can start looking for trips, not understanding, not healing, for trips. And it will get you, man. It will get you because it's beautiful. And the next thing you know, you're hooked on that because it can happen. It's medicine, but it's beautiful and you want to experience it again and again.
Right.
And
yep.
Until I know, something bad happens.
I know exactly what you mean, man.
Yeah.
I've experienced that on different things, and it's weird. It's like all of them, no matter what you think about them, demand respect. I mean, even something like cannabis, everybody uses cannabis, and nobody, it's like considered a party drug, and you know, it's just something to have fun and relax. But I tripped out. My very first time using cannabis was an edible, and it was really strong, and I had full closed eye visions.
Wow.
And it blew my mind, obviously. Because it was the first psychedelic experience I ever had, and I didn't know what, I never expected it. So then once I saw it, I was like, well, I want to see that again. So then I waited a couple weeks, and I tried it again, and it got darker. And then I did that same thing again. I was like, well, that wasn't like what I saw before. So then I waited a couple more weeks, and I tried it again, and it was even darker, and it was kind of scary. And it was because I wasn't approaching it to see what it had to teach me. I was just looking for that good time that I had that first time. I was chasing that trip, and I wasn't respecting it for what it could teach me. And then after I realized, and that really broke me down and realized that all of the psychedelic drugs, although there can be moments of intense pleasure and euphoria, they are not recreational drugs because they have too much power and they have too much to teach you.
Exactly.
I ended up having a trip that showed me one of my fears. So I'm really close with my dad, and he's always been like my hero and my best friend. And I often have gotten scared or sad just thinking about the day that someday it will come that he'll die. You know, he's getting older. He's almost 60 now, and you know, we don't live forever. But that's just a thought that's bothered me. But at the same time, you know, you're scared that somebody's going to die, but then For some reason, we also don't think that people die until they do. You know, we're just like, you don't think of it like that. So one morning, I took one of these same cannabis edibles, and I laid in my basement floor on like the hard concrete, and I just closed my eyes to see what it was going to show me, and it started out okay, and it was kind of showing me like I saw like a bird eating a worm. I saw a bunch of different things. But then all of a sudden I saw my dad as a child, and he was playing, and as he was running around and playing, he got a little older, and then before my eyes, I watched my dad grow up from being a little kid to a young boy to a teenager to a young man, and all the way until how old he is now. And then he continued going, and he aged. Wow. He got older, and then I watched him in this vision. I watched him die. And
wow.
I mean, at the moment I was terrified, and I was crying, and I was just grieving and just feeling like all the emotions you would feel watching your father die. But I knew it wasn't real, but mm-hmm. cannabis, the spirit of cannabis, the actual teacher was showing me, it was showing me, hey, this is what you're afraid of, and it is absolutely going to happen. So you need to choose how you're going to use that information. And that information should be something I use to teach me to spend more quality time with my dad while I have him, and to enjoy as much time as I can with him. But also to realize, he is going to die someday, and I need to be prepared for that as well. And you don't get to hold on to your parents forever. And and I mean, that's a lesson I got from cannabis that, I mean, it just blows my mind. And I just have so much respect for all the psychedelics, even the ones that aren't from nature. They are all still like spiritual, and they have their own intentions.
Entity.
Yeah. Sorry for coughing, but yeah, this is not something that I think you take for a party, or just to have a good time.
I mean,
there are moments of that, and I'm not telling you to feel guilty for having pleasure while consuming a substance. And maybe the lesson is that you need to have more fun. Maybe you're too serious.
Exactly, man. Exactly.
But I just think no matter what, you need to approach these substances with respect and love.
Yeah, love, man, love.
And you saw that. I could see that. That's the lesson you were getting too. It's just the respect one there at the end with your visions,
exactly.
The peyote with the claw.
Yeah, just to be respectful, man, because.
Yeah.
Those things are there for a reason. But that's the lesson we can get from everything.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know, it's super funny, isn't it? Because those things are like clear. You say it like, oh, okay, it makes sense. But with psychedelics, it's like, course, it's like a super big realization.
Yes,
that it changes your life.
Yeah, that's I try to explain that to people all the time. It's like, you could tell me, hey, you need to spend more time with your dad.
Exactly.
And I'd be like, yeah, you're right. You're probably right, but it's not going to affect my behavior like that, you know.
Yeah.
And it's exactly. they're hyper real. They're more real than real. Is
they are, man, they are.
Yeah, it's incredible.
It's incredible, man. And super cool that you look at that with so much respect, and that's the thing, you know. With the peyote, the first time I didn't have any fear to die, you know. So it just and to try new things, to explore, and to live life like as it is,
right?
As a journey of discovery. And for me, I understand. After many things, I completely got why I am here. And when you get that, when you sense that your life has a meaning, well, things just happen.
Yeah.
When you remember the mission of your life, all the things will come up. And so I didn't, so I lose my fear to live my life, you know?
Right.
And that's why right now I'm planning a trip to India to get, because I'm not going, here in Mexico, I'm not going to retire from a corporate job. It's not going to happen. Right now, I cannot afford a house.
Right.
Even though I am well paid or everything, having a job like that, it's not going to solve my problems. It's just going to chain me to something that I despise. And I don't know if it happens to you or it happens to anyone else, that when you're thinking and you're having these thoughts and you are experiencing these kind of things, you wish that everyone can do the same.
Yeah.
Because it's good. You're not going to like get high and well.
Yeah. Yeah, I wish that everyone could. And I totally agree with you about the job thing too. You know, and that's something I'm kind of getting myself, I don't know, it's something I've been spending a lot of thought and turmoil with the last few days, because I just, I know I messaged you about this, but I just started going through the process of divorce, and being separated from my wife, which means like I'm going to have to, because I have two children and I have to be able to support them, but I also now have to go out and find a new place to live. And, and like my house was like a couple months away from being paid off. And I was so close, I thought, to having some financial freedom to where I could do more. But now that's kind of just getting pulled out, and I've got to readjust, and I don't really know. Like you said, everything happens for a reason, and maybe I would have had too much freedom too soon or something. I don't know, but yeah, I got to pretty much reconfigure my whole life now. Like in the next 2 weeks, I got to get this all figured out and sorted, and it's going to be a process. It's going to be a lot of work. And
I cannot even comprehend the pain or the suffering that you're having, you know?
Yeah.
But
yeah, I've been going through it, but I just keep trying, and I don't believe in any religion, but I keep thinking about what the Buddhists say about attachments are the cause of all your suffering, and just trying not to be too attached to the relationship, because it's done now, and I can't go back, and I can't change things. And so I just, at this present moment right now, which is all there is, right now I'm feeling peace. There's a lot of unknown, but I do feel a lot of peace right now that I haven't that I haven't felt in the last 2 days. But right now, I feel pretty at peace.
Oh, that's beautiful, man.
It might just be your story, though, because it was incredible.
No, man, you will see at some point that all has reason. And well, it's going to, I don't know, maybe think about that. You will start a new path in your life. Everything is going to be different. It doesn't mean that it's going to be better or worse, just different. That's what changes are. And well,
Well,
if you need anything or just someone to talk with, just let me know, man. I'm super glad to have friends around the world.
yeah, absolutely. I mean, not to talk down on anybody else, but this is my favorite podcast I've had so far, for sure.
Oh, thanks, man. I
You're
know this is my first time, and I was super excited. I wanted to share lots of.
Well, you're an incredible storyteller, man.
Oh, thanks, man.
But
Thanks.
I think a big part of what makes yours so different from the others I've listened to already is just the amount of work that you had to do to make the experience happen was more of an experience than a lot of people get with psychedelics to begin with. I mean, that was
Exactly.
a lot of physical work, danger. I mean, I don't know if how afraid you were, but I would have been terrified in the desert at night. I mean, I'm totally afraid of snakes, and that's, oh, I can't even comprehend it.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Yeah. Yeah,
It's a
man.
trip, you know. There are people all from around this country that come to this place just to do that. There
Right.
are people that have come from even farther just to go there. So you know that place is important.
Yes.
It's funny because even in the desert, there are strange things that are going on there. You can hear all the stories about great people people that live there that have seen like strange circles in the sky, and oh, it's interesting and it's scary.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, just everything happens for a reason, man, and I wish you the very best. And
Thank you.
well, even though it's you're going to learn a lot from that,
Yeah.
and I wish you the best in your path, and you will see. You will see. I just don't want to miss the opportunity to
Yeah.
something good. We
Yeah.
all need that when we're in a difficult moment in our life, but it will pass, I
Right.
promise. I'm just a simple magician, but yeah, you will find much richer things along the way. But yeah, if you ever can, come to Mexico.
Absolutely, man.
There are many friends that will happily want to know you, man. That's the thing with traveling, man. It widens your vision so much
Yeah.
because when you start seeing that, well, hearing where I'm from, not even a single girl looks at me, but where I'm in a different place, like I'm on the center of the attention, it's also cool, you know?
Yeah.
Yes, it's something that to totally recommend to everyone that can just start traveling for a while. It's not for everyone also, but there are ways. For everyone that's interested, maybe search for couch surfing for getting a free accommodation, or maybe like doing work as a volunteer in around the world. You know, there are places like HelpX or Workaway that can help a lot with that.
Okay.
So that's what I'm trying to do right now with my life. I'm about to leave this corporate job I have just to first try to help people. I want to go to the south to start building houses, teach whatever I can, math. I used to be a math teacher. That's how I got into magic. And then it just evolved to try to get girls. And do you know what the funny thing is?
What?
It works, man. Have you ever read The Game by Neil Strauss?
No, I haven't.
Read that book, man. And when you read that, read the second one. It will probably help you when you're feeling down, man. The Game from Neil Strauss.
Okay.
It's just how that guy was like an average frustrated champ and got into like a pickup artist. And the thing is that you have to do you have to have better things to do to get women than going to places to get women.
Yeah.
So it was also a realization for me. And that's also one of the things I learned from that video, just to be patient.
Yeah.
I think so all of my relationships have been a mess. I blame myself for most of them. Well, for all of them.
Yeah.
But
I feel you there, man.
Yeah.
And I'm going to need to put a lot of patience in here for a while. I'm not looking to get into another relationship for a long time.
Yeah, how old are you, man?
I'm 27.
Oh, really? So we're almost the same age.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're with two children and everything. Wow.
Yeah.
How is it, man?
It's very rewarding, but it changes everything, man. It totally flips your life upside down. Because you can't live for yourself anymore.
Oh, I can.
You got these little faces that look at you.
Yeah, I think it also must be beautiful.
It is. It's very beautiful, and
it gives
your life so much more meaning, and I don't know, man. It's just very satisfying.
Oh, I can hear the energy in your voice. I know that you are a smiling man. When you think about those kids, I bet you're smiling. So keep that smile and stiffen up. You're going to need that. It's patience, but that will pass. If you look at me, I'm almost, I don't know how it's, how feet, I'm 2 meters tall. I think I look like an orc from the Lord of the Rings. And we all have to be patient. Patient.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's going to happen.
Yeah. Man, this has been a great talk, man. I totally appreciate you coming on and sharing this story for the world. And yeah, I'll definitely have to get you back on here again because you're a great storyteller and I want to listen to some more stories you have.
Oh, thanks, man. I'd be super happy to be here and tell you about all the people I met, all the stories about DMT, salvia, and everything.
Yeah.
That's only my first trip in the desert. I've had three, everyone with a different story, different understanding, and different output, and how everything just.
Yeah, well, we'll definitely have you back on soon so we can get more into those because I'm super excited to hear them.
Yeah, super excited to be here, man. There are many things I still wanted to talk about, how when I got this, like, my spiritual awakening.
Yeah.
I was in shock and everything. I was like, I was looking at my hands and I was like, what am I? I was looking at the water because I was taking a shower. What is this? And for a second, I was like, I know everything.
Yeah.
I got it. I could connect all the dots and everything just made sense, and just
you are the universe just, looking at itself.
Exactly, man. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. It's my whole reality just was destroyed for a second, then revealed moments after that.
Oh yeah. That's an experience I wish everybody had.
Yeah, man, it's scary. It's scary, man.
Yeah.
Because the first thing is you don't know what to do anymore.
Yeah.
But then it just makes sense. You say, okay, I'm going to do this. And if not, that's okay. I'm here for a reason. And I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. And if not, I'll try something else. It's beautiful, man. It's beautiful. So the psychedelic experience and talking consciousness and getting more in touch with nature, that I think that's one of the most important things.
Yeah.
Have respect, have love for everything, for everyone, not everything. Things are just material.
Right. Right.
And there are many, many things around the world that I wish everyone could share. We can learn from each other. So yeah, anytime I'm down to have another talk, I'll be following a lot of this podcast. I'm super, super happy to be here. Thank you so much for having me here. It's beautiful. I really appreciate you taking the time to just talk with me, and for all the listeners to be here. And also one quick shout out to a friend in India, Sneha. Sneha, you're the best. You're a great person. You're a great friend. I thank you so much for listening to me and your kind words. And you know what I need to hear when it's the time. So Sneha, lots of hugs. And yeah, to everyone, thank you so much.
Right on, man. All right. Well, thank you everybody again for listening to the Talking Consciousness podcast. And we'll have another episode out for you next Monday. So we'll see you then.